I'm very excited and proud to be joined by Vishal Sikka, who's the CEO of Infosys, and Alan Kay, who is a foundational researcher in computer science. And I'm trying to figure out a way to say Alan's a big deal without actually saying Alan's a big deal. The collection of inventions that Alan was part of a group of in the 70s that led to the internet, mouse, laser printing, the window, Ethernet, music synthesis on digital computers.
WYSIWYG word processing.
WYSIWYG word processing, PostScript, you know, kind of everything.
Smart.
Right? Everything except for HTML, it seems, was invented.
Oh, we already knew that was bad.
Yeah, exactly. And it gives you an idea about what the talk's going to be like now. So, you know, look, Alan, I think one thing to be really interesting for the audience is for you to just kind of reflect on the culture of that time that led to such a inflow of invention, and also some of the sort of sizing and economics of the group that did it, and how you were able to assemble a group with yourself and your collaborators who were able to do so much.
If I had to characterize the ARPA community, ARPA Park community, I would say that this was a community that knew how to argue and never tried to win. And they used argument as a way of allowing an enormous diversity of points of view to coexist in coherent projects that actually got things done. Some of the people who worked on these realized, like John McCarthy, who was one of the great people in our field in the late 50s, said, you know, if we thought about this as a power and lighting utility or like supplying water, then everybody could have one of these terminals in their home. And it would be a national facility that you'd hook into that would have all the world's knowledge on it. It would be interactive. And he even posited the kind of user interface that you would actually need for that. Another guy, the guy who actually invented the mouse, Engelbart, a few years later, said, whenever anything good or bad happens, it almost always happens with people working in groups. And good is more difficult than bad, and so we should really make a system that will augment people trying to do good things. And in many ways, that was the origin of the spirit of personal computing, which started with some money left over from ARPA as the space program moved to NASA. And in a couple of years, there were 15 places around the US funded extremely well. The control was left to the scientists, and the funders took care of supplying them with funds. And so this is a very lofty, well-funded, shoot for way beyond the moon. For instance, memo from 1963 by the guy who started all this, Licklider, was addressed to the members of the intergalactic networking community. And people said, well, why are you calling for an intergalactic network? And he said, because engineers always give you the minimum, and I want a worldwide network, so I'm asking for an intergalactic one.
So you and a group of people at Xerox decided to implement all the great ideas of computer science that have been written down by idealists since the 60s, and you pulled it off. How many people, how much time?
Took those, we say 8.5 inventions, because we were part of that community I mentioned, and many of us worked on the ARPANET, and we supplied about half the internet. So 8.5 inventions, the estimate is $35 trillion worth of wealth created, grand total of 25 computer scientists did it all. We not only invented the stuff, but we actually built all of our own hardware and software from scratch. That was one of the secrets. It's a big gamble. You have to have chops to do it, but if you do it, you're actually in a place where you can think thoughts that are unfettered by any kind of practical reality, and then there's a point where you have to sit down and make the hardware and software to do the thing.
Well, Vishal, I want to talk to you a little about something you said yesterday as well. You talked a lot about design-oriented thinking being a key thing that you're training individuals in. I mean, the essence of what Alan's been talking about is, you know, design plus engineering plus discipline plus a bit of luck has created $35 trillion. How should the people in the audience be changing the way they think about what they do?
Our brains get programmed to problem solve and not to problem find. We tend to govern our lives by doing things that we are told, or doing things that are in front of us, by seeing what is there. And we usually don't look for things that are not there, things that could make things better. And design thinking is fundamentally an approach to help us systematically find things that are not there, that could make things better. So one of the endeavors is, how do you make ourselves systematically better at that? We have already in the last 3.5 months taught 12,300 people this design thinking class. Some of them have taken a day-long class, some have taken a two-day-long class. So there's only so much that you can learn in a day-long class. But my hope is that over the course of that day, and then reflecting on that day, a click happens that when you look at a room, like the room that we are sitting in, you don't just see what is there, but you also bring your imagination to bear on what could make this better.
It's really a challenge. Training matters, communication matters, but culture matters as well. Do you want to share your comments and your comments on the topic of technology, culture, and their interactions?
If you look at great service organizations, they inevitably create a great culture. And if you look at hospitals, lawyers, airlines, armed forces, places which create a context, a culture around the individuals that work there, of course it is all about the individual. The surgeon is the one who performs the surgery, the lawyer is the one who performs the services. But there is a context around them which makes them extraordinarily more powerful than what they are. And so when you look at a company like mine of 180,000 people, the culture that surrounds us has the potential to turn us into incredibly powerful people, doing amazing things which are amplified by the technology and the culture that surrounds us. It can also be a significant, de-amplifier or a sort of a subduer, if you will, of the work that we do. So culture makes a huge difference, and we don't spend enough time on it.
So, you know, how do you think about how culture and the culture of service, the culture of interaction can still project itself through technology?
I think good technology always amplifies us, has the potential to amplify us. Automation and AI have a tremendous potential to improve the things that we do, to bring our judgment to bear, to make us more focused, to make us more productive. And that should be our endeavor. And if we are relying on, less than perfect services and sites and not on the human judgment, perhaps there is something wrong with that. Yeah. So that is my sense, is to have technology amplify the ability of people to do more, or to be more capable than we are in natural and good ways. And I think that is at the heart of the renewal of Infosys that I am after. The important thing when we think about the change in an organization is to keep in mind that the future does not just have to be an increment of the present or of the past. It can, in fact, be something that you can shape with your imagination, with your hands.
But Alan, it seems we're starting to get some interesting AI. It seems data science has a promise that we can do at scale that wasn't there before. But it also seems like we still can't quite not have our web browsers crash. Right? And so something's not quite right, and something's pretty exciting. Where are you fearful? Where are you hopeful?
The engineering aspects of the hardware part of it have been stunningly impressive. There's no question about it. It's just fantastic that the internet turned out the way we thought it would, because that was a real gamble. So that's wonderful. Web browser could not have been designed in a worse way in almost every aspect of it. Almost nobody knows this. That says something about the people who are using computers today, that they have no way of looking at it and seeing what's right or what's wrong. And the way programming is done today is little changed from the late 60s. Most of the languages used would be quite familiar to late 60s people, and that's killing everybody because it's generating enormous, fragile, non-understood code that is only paid, people who pay for it only pay to get it out and deployed, and they leave to the future the 80% of the cost, which is now consumed by just maintaining legacy code. If you think about that 80%, it is actually the thing that, one of the big things that's killing progress, because companies have to hire people who know the old programming languages in order to maintain the legacy software, and they're getting exactly the wrong people in, but they've created this mess for themselves, and now they're spending all of their time dealing with their garbage rather than making gardens. So it's a spectrum of things, and the number one way, don't believe me, but just find a way of criticizing the whole enterprise, and you'll start seeing some of the things that I'm mentioning.
So now's the time to embrace learning, embrace failure, embrace change, and actually think about computing not as something done by the other, not as something done by the person in the, yes, in the back room, but think about it as the sort of fundamental DNA of the new context of your life.
Your point is very true. One of my favorite books is Siddhartha by Hermann Hesse. Towards the end of the book, he makes a very interesting point through the character of Siddhartha, that knowledge is something that can be taught and can be communicated, but wisdom is something that we find for ourselves. And in the end, all these technologies, all these capabilities, our ability to author, our ability to learn, our ability to improve ourselves, comes down to us being able to find our own unique wisdoms that nobody else can teach that. So my greater sense and purpose of technology is to have it help us find out what our own unique, you know, wisdom.
Mm. Wow, and so that ended on a big picture note. Alan and Vishal, thank you so much.
Thank you.